Thanks, brother. I appreciate it. Well, good morning, Bethany. It is really good to see you this morning. Today, as we mentioned last week, today we're going to begin a new series going through the book of Philippians that we simply have just titled Joyful. And over the past month, the pastors and the preaching team, we've been praying and seeking God, just saying, all right, Lord, where do you want to take us as a church? What is it that you're wanting us to study, to go through? What is it that you have for us that you're calling us to? And as we've been praying and we looked at a couple different options, as we came to the book of Philippians, we were just in complete unity, believing that this was the direction that God was taking us, that he wanted us to go here and begin to just study and dive into as a church. And if you've studied the book of Philippians before, you might remember there's this constant theme throughout the book of Philippians, this theme of joy. And even though it's a really short book, just four chapters long, you have this idea of joy or this call to rejoice. It's mentioned at least 15 times throughout the book. I think there's a powerful message for us, church, something that God has for us that he's specifically calling us to. And we believe this is the right time that God's wanting to show us some things through his word, through the book of Philippians, for us at Bethany Church this summer specifically. And so we're excited to be going through that together. So before we get into that more, let's get into the book of Philippians together. Turn with me to Philippians chapter 1, right at the very beginning of Philippians. If you're trying to find it, you're going to find Philippians in the New Testament. It's actually, like I said, a short book. It's in the middle of several short books, about halfway into the New Testament. You can be looking for that through there, and getting past some of the longer ones, you'll get past Acts, you'll get past Romans, and start looking there. You'll find Philippians pretty quickly. But as you're doing that, I just want to maybe set up this book a little bit as we're getting ready to go into it. The book of Philippians is actually a letter that was written by the Apostle Paul. It was written to a church that he had helped build in the city of Philippi. And what's really encouraging about this letter is that this letter, as you begin to read it, you realize it was meant to just be something encouraging, something edifying for the church. Often when Paul, he'd be writing letters, as he would write these letters, he'd often have to come with maybe need to address an issue that was going on in the life of the church, maybe confront something that wasn't right or wasn't healthy. But as you read the book of Philippians, there's a different tone to that. You almost get this feeling like Paul is writing to this beloved friend who he loves and he just misses so much. And so he's writing them just to update them on what's going on in his life. And he's writing to encourage them based on what God is doing and the situations that he is in as he wants to bless them, because he loves them so much. And so let's do that. That takes us to Philippians chapter 1. And we're going to start with just the first 8 verses this morning. So let's read that together. Philippians chapter 1. We're going to start with the first 8 verses. It starts like this. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are at Philippi with the overseers and deacons, grace to you and peace from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, for you are all making my prayer with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to feel this way about you all, because I hold you in my heart, for you are all partakers with me of grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness how I yearn for you all with the affection of Christ Jesus. There's a lot in just these few verses, but one of the big things that stands out to us as we begin to look at this is part of the power that comes with the book of Philippians is realizing that as he talks about this encouragement, talks about this topic of joy, it's significant because of what we see in verse 7. Paul's actually writing this from prison. He's writing this from Rome. He's under house arrest, and we're not sure at the exact time that the letter happens or where exactly in his imprisonment that it's writing, but as he's writing this, it's very likely near the end of Paul's life. And not only that, actually, if we look at the letter, we'll see that Paul suspected it was potentially near the end of his life. And there's something powerful when you begin to read the words of someone that knows that maybe he's in his last moments on earth. And so while under arrest, unsure if he'll ever be free again, Paul writes this letter to the church that he loved very much. He mentioned his affection for them in verse 8. He was grateful to them. He talks about that in verse 3 and how he sees them as his true partners in ministry as he talks about that in verse 5. And so you just see this beautiful picture of his relationship with the church and how he's just wanting to share with them what he's going through. And in verse 4, we come to Paul's first mention of the word joy. He says he's praying for them with great joy. As I mentioned earlier, joy is the big theme that's echoed throughout this book. And so as we come into Philippians, our first week, it's really important that we come, maybe first starting, taking a few minutes to look at this topic of joy. Before we get into this book, I think we want to start with this foundational understanding. What is it that Paul is writing about over and over again in the book of Philippians? Because joy is an interesting word, and it comes with a lot of different ideas. And the more I talk to other people, the more I realize it's not something that's so simple to define. Often when I talk to people about the idea of joy, and maybe you can relate to this, one of the first things they'll say to me is they'll say, well, joy is not happiness, which I would agree with and say, I agree with you. I'm on the same page with you. So what is joy? And then it becomes a little bit more difficult. I was actually talking with a friend last week. We were getting ready for this series, and we were talking about this idea of joy, and this big smile got on his face as he began to try to define it. And you could tell in his mind, he felt confident that he knew what joy was. But as soon as he began to try to articulate, began to define it, we both found it's not as simple as we might want to think it is to just define something that we see echoed throughout God's word over and over again. So knowing that, I believe that's why it's so important for us. Let's really take some time and slow down a little bit today and just look at this idea of joy that God is wanting us to understand throughout the book of Philippians together. Because when we talk about this idea of joy, we're talking about, and this is really important, God's definition of joy. We can go look up joy in the dictionary, but that's not what we're talking about. When God writes it, when God is talking to us, when he's calling us to joy, we need to hear what God means by that. And part of that is starting to understand what it doesn't mean, because there's some important things we got to hear. We got to hear that, one, we cannot just create joy on our own. We fall into that trap sometimes. We can't just wish enough joy to come on ourselves, or just somehow think hard enough and get ourselves to feel, or even try and just manufacture feeling joy. In fact, joy itself actually comes only through the power of the Holy Spirit that is in us. When Paul was writing to a different church in the book of Galatians, he was writing specifically on what he called the fruit of the Spirit. And when he talked about in Galatians chapter 5, the fruit of the Spirit, he says, but the fruit of the Spirit, one of them is joy. It's something that we need to understand, this idea of joy. When the Bible talks about it, it's something that cannot be found apart from the power of the Holy Spirit and the lives of those who have given themselves to God and where the Holy Spirit has come and indwelt us and began his work in us. In fact, I would say when we begin growing in our relationship with God, when the Holy Spirit comes and dwells us and we begin this relationship that God invites us to, we begin to walk with him, as we grow in that relationship with God, I believe what happens, we also grow in our ability to experience joy. Not because we necessarily know a lot more information, but because part of it is as we grow in our relationship with God, we grow in our intimacy with God. And as we know more about God and our relationship with him grows and our intimacy with him grows, then out of that begins to overflow the ability to find joy in him and our relationship in him. And so it's so important, not only this morning, but as we continue on through the summer and that theme of joy or that call to rejoice keeps coming back, that we hear everything is having this foundation that is rooted in the transformational work of the Holy Spirit. It's not something that we can do. It's something that God does in our lives, and we have to start there. And this is so important, because when we come to this topic of joy, often when I discuss it with people, I find that there's this tension surrounding this topic. There's something that people struggle with, that they're wrestling with. And often I hear things, well, if I can't find joy, then you must be saying that I'm just not a good enough Christian. If I can't seem to just turn it on, because the Bible says to just count it all joy, if I can't seem to do that, then there must be something wrong with me. Or even it can go a little deeper where they begin to even feel some anger. Maybe you can relate to this because of the way joy has been talked about. Maybe the way in a Bible study or even a pastor has talked to you about it, you walked away feeling, well, because I can't just seem to just do what it says I'm supposed to do, that somehow I'm not good enough. And I think that that tension is part of why we struggle so much trying to define joy, because there's a lot of baggage that's even wrapped up in this topic, a lot of baggage even wrapped up in this word. So as we go into that, I found two definitions I want us to start from this morning as I was studying this week from two separate pastors. And I want to give them both to you because I thought they both bring this picture, they complete this picture of what I think Paul is talking about in the book of Philippians as he begins to talk about joy. I want to look at these two with you. The first one is by Pastor John Piper. And he says this, he says, remember that joy is not the absence of negative feelings or hurts or pains. That's an important starting point. But he describes joy as this. He says, Christian joy, that begins with where we get it, the Holy Spirit. Christian joy is an additional feeling, a good feeling, produced by the Holy Spirit as he causes us to see who God is and respond in trust to what he says that he will do. And then Pastor Rick Warren, he had this, which I think builds beautifully with what John Piper was saying. He says, joy is the settled assurance that God is in control of all the details of my life, the quiet confidence that ultimately everything is going to be all right, and the determined choice to praise God in every situation. Like I said, I think these two definitions, they bring a great picture, maybe a completion of these different ideas of joy that we hear or maybe talk about or have heard out there, and they bring them to give us a better understanding of what I think Paul is wanting us to see and know and even understand about joy when he mentions it throughout this book. But even as we read these definitions, I think there's some underlying truths that come from those that we need to understand that maybe we don't hear enough, or we haven't ever been told, or we don't seem to understand. And one of the big ones is that we need to understand that joy is not instant. You got to hear this morning. Joy is not instant. Joy is a journey. To say to someone when they are going through pain, when they're struggling, when they are hurting, to say, listen, just be joyful, is as ignorant as me coming up to them, shooting them in the leg, and saying, just get up and walk if you just have enough faith. It's inconceivable to think of doing such a thing with shooting them a leg and expecting them to do that, but we tend to do that with this topic of joy, and we don't recognize that circumstances really do affect us. Situations affect us. God made us not just thinkers. He made us feelers. Created in the image of God, we are both thinkers and feelers, and when we run into circumstances, all those things come together in our lives, and to somehow pretend as we're going through some painful, difficult situations, when we're pressing on, when we're struggling, when we're going through things that are the very things that tend to rob us of joy, to somehow think that I can just somehow just fix it myself right there in some instant moment is ignorant, one, of what joy is, but it's ignorant of who I am, who God created me to be. My own struggle with flesh, my own struggle with circumstances, with pain, with things going on around me. And it's not easy. And so I want to speak to you this morning. If you've been taught, if you've been told that joy is just something you should just have and it's just easy, and whenever you're going through a hard time, you should just be joyful. If that's what's been told to you, I want to say to you, I'm sorry. I don't believe that's what the Bible teaches us. In fact, it doesn't even make sense in light of what the Bible tells us it means to learn and grow more in our relationship with Christ. Nothing in our Christian life becoming more and more like Christ is just instant, just a switch that we can be turned on, that we can just turn on like that. So when we come to define this idea of joy, not only do you have to realize that joy is not that switch, we have to also know that joy, and this is so important, we miss this, joy is not the absence of sorrow. Joy is not the absence of pain. Joy is not the absence of sadness or hurt. Joy is what God can do, what God begins to do, what he can give us through the power of the Holy Spirit in the middle of life circumstances. When we are in good times and when we are in difficult times, it's about what the Holy Spirit can do. It has the potential for us to be a solid foundation that we can, in the middle of crisis, in the middle of pain, that we can rest on, even a solid feeling, and I'm going to get to that more in just a moment, even a solid feeling that we can have in the middle of pain, in the middle of sorrow, because the root of joy is the root of who God is. And when God is our foundation, when who he is, and what he's done, and we're going to get to that too in just a second, becomes that foundation. Then it becomes something that we can land on while still experiencing pain and suffering. And Paul gives us a great example of that. In fact, Paul wrote about this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. It's a verse we might be familiar with. And he was describing the moment that might be the most painful moment for many of us in life, the moment when someone we love dies or passes away. And he's writing to the church, and he says this in 1 Thessalonians 4:13, and he wants to encourage them. And he says, "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, who have died, that you may not grieve as others who have no hope." Don't grieve as others do who have no hope. And there's a couple of things to note here. One, God is not telling us not to grieve. That's not what God says to us. God is showing us how to grieve, how in the middle of pain, in the middle of sorrow, in the middle of even tears coming out of our eyes, in our sadness and brokenness, how God can help lead us and take us to a place where we can have joy even in the middle of that pain. He says we can grieve the sorrow and still have hope, which is where we can begin to find and walk that journey to find joy at the same time. Because he's not saying grieve and still be happy. That's an important distinction we got to make around this idea of joy, which is where all that confusion can sometimes come in. We are not happy in all situations. We are not happy when someone we love dies. We are not happy when we look around us and we look at our nation and we see the pain that people are going through. We see the turmoil. We see the loss of life, the destruction, and the injustice that is happening because of all the brokenness in the world around us. Instead, in the middle of these times, in the middle of the most painful times, we cry and we weep and we pour our heart out to God and we grieve. And at the same time, we want to come back and fall into the arms of our Heavenly Father as we cry out, as we grieve, and let him hold us and remind us of the hope that we have. And in that hope of who he is, both in death and in life, confidence in his promises of what he even says for those who have been saved, that they experience eternal life, that we get to see again, all that comes with that. Because of God's promises, we begin to find joy in God, even in pain. And when we can begin, and it's a process that God takes us through, to find joy in pain as we dig into him more, as we pursue him more, then as we get into that more, then we can begin, because of that joy, begin to rejoice even in pain. We begin to find a place where we can rejoice in the Lord always, as Paul says in Philippians, and still be in moments of grieving and sorrow. And I know that this sounds like a contradiction. Please hear me. I understand that. And sometimes I think we miss the way God really has wired us. That at the same time, we can experience things that feel contradicting. As a parent, there is no greater example of feeling those contradicting things. That when I see my kid when he was 2 years old and he drew on the wall, as I was frustrated, getting angry, thinking he's super cute, loving him, wanting to celebrate his creativity, and at the same time tell him please never draw on the wall again and make sure he hears that as a clear, stern answer, there's a lot of conflicting emotions there, and they're all making sense. None of them are relatively wrong to that situation. So God made us. We're complicated people. And God made us to begin to pour into him to help find the way to walk and rest in him during those complicated moments. And so that takes us back to what Paul says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. We talked about joy. Now let's get into, as he begins to speak to them, he's talking to the church, this church he loves so much, and he begins to talk to them about joy, his joy that he finds in them as he prays for them. And look what he says right after that, Philippians 1, 6. He says, "I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ." Look what he says. I am sure of this. Paul is giving us a picture. He's giving us an idea of what he's going to unpack, I think, a lot more later on in this letter when it comes to this idea of joy. But what it is, when he says, "I am sure of this," he's giving us insight into what his foundation is. where he builds the idea, the ability to begin to find joy in the middle of tough situations. Though he misses them, he still finds joy in them, though he's sad. Because what he's doing in verse 6, he's reminding us of a couple of things. His foundation is on two things. One, who God is and what God will do. This is Paul's foundation. It's on who God is. So when he says who God is, the one who saved him, the one who found him in his brokenness. Hey, Paul was the guy that said, I am the worst of sinners. You can imagine he appreciated and loved desperately so much the grace that God had shown him. And so he can remember who God is, the one that reached out in his own brokenness while he was in sin, the Savior that reached out and invited him into relationship with him, that reconciled him and God, reconciles us and God, and all that God has done to bring us to where we are right now. But not only who God is the one who has saved us and redeemed us, it also reminds us of what God will do. Confidence in God's faithfulness, in his promises, that he will complete this good work, that he's going to finish and accomplish exactly what he wants to do, that we can remember in the middle of pain that he says one day he'll wipe every tear from our eye. In the middle of watching injustice just stir around us, that he said he is going to make all things right, that he is going to restore and establish justice and truth, that God will do what he says he's going to do in my own life. He'll bring it to completion for what is good for his glory and his kingdom, but also in the lives of everyone around me, in the world around me, that God is going to do what he says he will do because of who God is, his faithfulness and confidence in what he has also done. This is Paul's foundation for joy. If we can't see that, we're going to have a hard time really finding the joy that God invites us to in our relationship with him. Because circumstances are going to change. Things around us are going to be good. Things around us are going to be bad. They're going to be hard. They're going to be difficult. In fact, I don't know if we're ever going to experience moments that don't have with them in some way difficulty, pain, and even sorrow. And that's why we got to remember joy isn't happiness, because happiness is based off what's happening. It's based off circumstances. And the thing is, happiness is not a bad thing. It's not like happiness is somehow the sinful version of joy. When I'm with my friends and we're laughing and we're having a good time and I'm happy because of the circumstances, that's a good thing. Happiness is not inherently bad. That's not what Scripture says when it makes this contrast. It's reminding us, though, that happiness is different than joy, because happiness is based on what's happening. It's based off circumstances. But joy is what we find in the middle of all circumstances, of all times. It's maybe realizing, or maybe we have to be reminded because we're hurting. Maybe we've even walked away a little bit from God and we're in the middle of something we're struggling with, and maybe we even feel like we got to start over. But in any of those circumstances, joy can be found as we come to God, even come back to God, to his promises. Remember what Paul said, he who began the good work, he's going to bring it to completion. He is moving. We remember that God is not done. And not only is God not done, remember that God is active at this very moment. That God is in the middle of what is happening. God is on the move in the middle of all pain, in the middle of all suffering. And so I just keep falling back on him. I keep coming back to my relationship with him on who God is, what he has done, and what I know he's going to do. And I want to close this morning with one example that we see from the life of the Apostle Paul. Because it's easy, and I can relate to this, it's easy to just preach something, to just say, this is what joy is, and just do it. But then to have to realize the reality of beginning to live it out, that can become a whole different world for me. I want to just close with the story of how Paul was beginning to practice, in a sense, what he preached. And the story is actually found in Acts chapter 16. It's found in the city of Philippi, the very place where Paul was writing to as he wrote this letter. See, Paul had been called by God in a vision to go to Philippi, to go there and preach the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ and to plant a church there, to birth the church right there. And it tells us that as he was going through the city and he was sharing the gospel, there was this slave girl who had a demon in her. And Paul turned around and he spoke to that demon and he cast it out of the slave girl. But what happens, those around her, those that were her bosses, those that owned her, were angry with what Paul did. They cast the demon out. They took away the whole advantage they had with the slave girl, how they were using her to make money. So it says that they stirred up the whole crowd, the whole city against Paul, and people became to come out, and they were shouting, they were jeering at them, and it says they began to attack them, and they took them before the leaders of the city. And as they were before the leaders of the city, listening to what the crowd with the mob was saying, took them and beat them with rods. Beat them, beat them, beat them, and then sent them and put them into prison. Now imagine this moment. Imagine what Paul would have been feeling, because you know what? Paul's human, just like we are. As he's in prison, he's bleeding. He's in pain. He's hurting. Paul's not happy with what's going on in his circumstances. In fact, we're told that he was even angry at what was happening, the injustice that was going on against him. If we look later on, I think it's around verse 37, we see where he stood up against the injustice that was happening to him. So not only was he hurting, not only was he in pain, but he was angry at what was going on, the wrong that was happening. And yet it says, in the middle of that, beaten and broken and shoved into prison unjustly, it says that Paul and the guy that was with him, his friend Silas, that while in prison, they were praying. And not only were they praying, it says they just began to sing out worship songs to God. They began to rejoice and worship God. And as I look at that point of the story, I have to ask myself, how were they able to do that? I love to sing. I love to worship God. I give me my guitar and just time to just be with God, and I'm going to have a blast doing that. And it seems like that would be my instinct. But if I'm really honest and I ask myself the question, would I be able to do what Paul did? Would I be able, in my anger and my frustration and my hurt and my pain, my sorrow, maybe even wondering, God, you sent me to Philippi. You told me to come here in a vision, and now I'm in prison, beaten and broken. Have to be asking what's going on. And I hope I never have to find out what I would really do in that situation. But we can look at Paul, and we can see somehow, in the middle of all of that, he was able to respond. In the middle of pain and still being angry, he began to respond with worship. And I think it's because of what Paul gives us a glimpse of in Philippians 1:6. The intro, the foundation of this book of joy that we're going to be going through as a church, he's reminding us that he is sure of this, that he who began the good work, even in the middle of being beaten, even in the middle of injustice, even in the middle of all that has been done wrong to him, and he is not happy with any of that, but in the middle of all of that, he who began a good work in him will be faithful to complete it and accomplish what is good and what is right and what is just. Again, we have to remember this about joy. Joy is not happiness. Joy is not the absence of pain. Joy is finding God in the middle of pain and sorrow, remembering who he is and what he has done. So why we still weep and we struggle, maybe even wrestle with our doubts and our fears, we come back to who God is and begin to let the power of the Holy Spirit work in us, remind us of God, begin to experience joy in the middle of all still the pain and sorrow and suffering. No, because even as we talk about this, I want to go back to what I said at the very beginning this morning. Because I recognize as we talk about this right now, that same tension that I mentioned earlier, the same frustration, the same struggle that often comes with this topic of joy, feeling inadequate, feeling like you can't do it, that could very well still be there right now. And I want you to hear this, and this is so important. As we begin today, I'm not expecting, and none of us should be expecting, that somehow, great, we heard a sermon on joy, we heard some good definitions, now we can just go and be joyful today and tomorrow. That goes against what we've been talking about today. It's not the light switch to turn on. What I hope today, as we as a church begin to go through the book of Philippians, that today begins that journey that I was talking about. That God begins to take us on this journey with him to build and grow into our relationship with him and our intimacy with him, and that as we grow in that, we begin to see what Paul could say near the end of Philippians in chapter 4. Paul actually comes and he says, I have learned how to do this. He says he's learned it. It wasn't something that just happened to Paul because he got saved and became a super Christian. In fact, God, even in the prison cell, Maybe God was teaching him before he began to pray, before he began to worship. Maybe God was, that was one of those moments where Paul was learning the foundational truth that he who began a good work will be faithful to complete it until the day of Christ Jesus. Church, this is the joy that we are going on right now. This is the journey that we're going on right now. You know what? When you say that you feel like you just can't do it, let me affirm that and say you are right. You just can't do it. But you know what? I can't do it, but God can. And this morning, maybe we just need God to speak to us a little bit by that Holy Spirit that begins to build that joy within us. Maybe we just got to come and be honest. If you've been struggling with joy or struggling with your relationship with God, maybe you just begin there. We've got a lot going on right now. I have been struggling with joy. Let me confess that to you right now. This week, as I began going through Philippians, I had to stop at one point and say, God, I just need you to teach me this right now before I can ever teach it. I'm struggling. And God, in his grace, the Spirit of God just began to speak and minister to me and to be able to come. But I had to surrender. I had to confess. And maybe that's where we start. I'm going to pray in just a moment. I want to just, as you go, as you're sitting there, as the worship team is playing the song, I want to invite you to just take moments before God. Don't feel like you got to sing or watch. Just go before God. A few moments of prayer, confessing, surrendering, letting God just know where you're at. Be real with God. He already knows. That's what we talked about with Psalms. We cry out. Let's be real with him. But then let's come back to that truth. Let's come back to the invitation that God presents to us today to respond to what Paul said of when he says, I am sure of this, he who began a good work will be faithful to complete it till the day that Christ Jesus returns. Let's pray together. God, I thank you so much for who you are. I thank you so much for what you have done and what you're going to do. And so this morning, Lord, we all of us have to say, none of us have arrived. We have, none of us have this figured out, and we are in desperate need to do what only the Holy Spirit, we need you to do what only the Holy Spirit can do in us. By the fruit of your Spirit, help us begin to see how to walk with you, to experience joy, to not pretend like everything's okay, not try to manufacture everything, and not to just give ourselves Bible answers, but to pour ourselves deep into you and who you are and say, you are good, you have done good, and you will do good. In the middle of my still, as the tears fall, I still am learning to find joy in you. God, as we begin this as a church, continue to walk us through this, Lord, that we would know what you have for us. Where we can say as a church, we rejoice in the Lord always. And again, we say rejoice. Thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen.